last time about getting up to speed in terms of our conceptual framework. Again, this gets boring, we're tired of this, but we can start to have different types of questions about the nature of the relation between X and Y, right? And we're looking, asking about what types of, what are the conditions, what are the boundary conditions, under what circumstances is X related to Y, and then when we start to see changes in that, what type of analysis we're talking about. Is that Candace?
Moderator,
right? So we're looking, sort of, can we get to a point where we see that X isn't related to Y, or what types of circumstances? We're talking about, thinking about, even if we're not saying it, but we're thinking it, or conceptualizing it this way, causal mechanisms, things that produce a relation between X and Y. We're not talking about mediators, right? Talked about causal steps. Original causal steps, remember, we were saying that X has to demonstrate a reliable relationship with our outcome, which makes sense from a conceptual standpoint, like, well, why would I expect something to be the mechanism of a non-relation? Right? We'll talk about some of the hang-ups there. In Judd and Kenny's original conceptualization, we're saying that each variable in the causal chain impacts the variable that follows it, when all prior are controlled, means that X predicts or impacts our mediator, and our Y is impacted by a mediator, and our outcome following all of their, our mediator is impacted by X, our Y is impacted by X, but then when we look at and regress Y onto our mediator and our X variable, X now demonstrates no relation after we have our mediator in the outcome, right? This relationship that was there goes away, which is makes conceptual sense if this is the mechanism that's causing that, right? Once we account for this, that's gone. There's no relationship right there, right? Now, some problems with this original conceptualization. Basically, with Baron Kenny's reformulation, we're saying that X has a significant relation with Y, so we're keeping that. And we're saying that X also demonstrates a reliable relation with our mediator, and our mediator demonstrates a significant relationship with our outcome. But the big thing that's going on here, we're saying that when A and B are controlled, path A, path B are controlled, this C prime is significantly reduced with the strongest evidence for mediation occurring when C prime is equal to zero. Okay. Judah, why is this probably improvement above and beyond the more stringent criteria for mediation? Do you remember?
Because you're probably still going to see some level of relationship, but as long as it's reduced significantly, then you can say that the mediator is
coming back. Exactly. We don't deal in perfect estimation of things, right? Like, we don't measure pure constructs. There's a lot of reasons why X might still have a relationship with Y, right? Also, tell me some process in human behavior that's caused by one mechanism and one mechanism alone, right? It's a pretty stringent criteria to say, oh, this is the thing that causes X to be related to Y, right? It's probably not reflective of how things actually work. And so, but what we want to do is we want to see that this C to C prime is, there's at least some reliable reduction, right? It's always going to be reduced to some extent. People are throwing something else in the model, right? We would expect that coefficient to start to shrink down. But what we want to do is we want to see that that reduces it far enough that we can say, yeah, there's some reliable indirect path going on here, okay? So again, our assumptions of our causal models, and again, this is why these are so difficult to establish. Because what you can do with cross-sectional data is you can just throw a bunch of variables in there, and who knows, we can start flip-flopping things all over the place, right? The basic assumptions is that X causes Y and Y doesn't cause X. We want to have either an empirical or a conceptual argument for why X causing Y versus Y causing X. We assume that the mediator precedes Y in time, the mediator is a plausible agent of Y. Again, best case scenario, you've got temporal relation. You measured this at this time, this at this time, and this at the other time. Then if you measured, if your mediator is measured after you measure Y, don't stick it in there because nothing in the future is going to impact something that happened in the past outside of theoretical physics and things like that, right? Which you see people do, like, oh, well, this change happened, this is what caused why, but that change didn't happen until after you already measured why. You can't make a strong argument. So, yeah.
What about when we're using self-report measures and the mediator is something that happened previously?
Yeah.
Or, like, could have existed.
Right. And so this is where you get into a conceptual argument, and hope your reviewers buy it, okay? I mean, seriously, this is the way it is. I mean, I've published papers looking at mediation models and tried to lay out, say, this is why we've set the model up this way. This is the theoretical, empirical arguments based on literature. This is all cross-sectional, right? But this is why we're laying out the model and have been able to, at least for whoever was reviewing the paper on that day, haven't really accept that, but Sharon and I and the lab put together a paper. We tried to lay out the same argument, and those reviewers said, "Not for this journal. We're just not going to let you. We're not accepting papers that don't have some sort of precedence. Like, it's fine if you want to say that, but it's just sort of not good enough for us, right?" Which obviously disappointed about, but I can't argue with it, right? If they're at that level, right? So again, wanting to say that your mediator assumes. And so now, if you, and sometimes you have like history variables, like I was in a car accident when I was 16, and I have PTSD right now, right? Like your PTSD right now is because of your car accident when you're 16, right? And so it doesn't all happen, need to be related temporally, but you want to go through and think about, like, how does this go through and fit together, right? And then what we're doing is we're assuming that the relation of X and Y is not the product of some unmeasured process or construct, right? So we can say, fine, you can make an argument that this is your mediator, but if I look at that and I'm like, no, that's not. It's you've got, there's a third variable out there that you didn't measure. That's a more plausible mediator than this. So that's probably what's going on here, right? Like, okay, I see that you think your condition is mediating this relation, but it's probably demand effects, because you sort of basically told your participants what you wanted them to do in this condition alone, and then they did it. You've got some problems there with your makeup, right? Other thing we need to be thinking about is that X has to be a plausible agent of the mediator, and the mediator has to be a plausible agent of Y, right? You just can't be rando stuff that we've said, oh yeah, this is the mechanism. Well, if it's, tell me why. Like, I have to believe that this is some variable, something that X causes this thing, that then in turn causes that thing, in order for me to believe this is a plausible model. Okay. But again, this is why these conceptually pretty straightforward, analytically not difficult to measure relative to moderation stuff like that. But from a defensive standpoint, to a methodological standpoint, much more difficult to put together a plausible mediation model relative to moderation analysis types of things. People comfortable with this? All right. Causal steps in terms of partial mediation stuff. Partial mediation is sort of, we're saying, all right, there's probably multiple things that are involved in causing X to be related to Y. You can't measure all of them, but we think that this is something that's big. This is something that at least should account for some of this relationship, right? Again, in social sciences, like, this is the one thing that causes everything else in this. Unless we're talking about self-esteem or negative affect, that causes everything, right? A number of different things, that conditions that can start to, in our models, cause that C path to not go away completely. There's still some residual stuff going on there. One, if we see that X has both a direct effect on Y and an indirect on Y through the mediator, right? So maybe our X variable, either, this is a mediator. This is some variable that accounts for this relationship, but X also has a director, like X directly causes Y, But of this pool, of this bivariate correlation, some of that is a direct effect, and some of it is sort of an indirect effect through the end, right? And so if we count for this, we'd expect the portion of this total correlation, say it's R of x, y equals 0.5, right? This is your total direct effect, right? But we would expect that if we account for this, that's going to go down, right? But we're still going to see some residual effect going on right here. And so we may not see C prime or go to zero. The relationship between x and y can also be mediated by several processes of final structure, only a subset included in the model, right? There's a lot of different reasons x are related to y. We've got two of them in our model. There's other stuff that we didn't capture, either because we didn't think about it, or we couldn't, for whatever reason. And so we would see partial mediation there. The thing to remember, though, is that technically this is a specification violation. Technically, what we've got, and we make these all the time, right? But we should take them more seriously. The basic assumption of regression is that all the variables in the model need to be in the model, or in the model knows it. Shouldn't be in the model, are in the model, right? So, again, this becomes incumbent on you as the investigator to start thinking about, okay, what are the things that I need to have in my model? And if I'm developing a project, have a good command in my literature and say, these are the big things, these are the things that I need to go through and have. Because if I don't, then I have some potential biases going on. We also have situations where the indirect effect of x on y through the mediator is not constant for all members of the population. So, you're ready to wrap your head around this, right? We've got a situation where x is related to y, and then the mediator does account for this relationship, but this relationship changes relative to whether or not we talk about minimum, right? So in this situation, we have an indirect relation, but that indirect relation, so maybe this is a mediator for men, but it's not for women, right? And so now all of a sudden, if we just lump men and women together and look at this, we'll see an indirect path, but we're still going to get a relationship here because them doesn't mediate that for women, but we've just kind of grouped everything together, right? And so what we would then look at, if we wanted to really start to tease this apart, we would say, with sex as a moderator of one of those three paths, right? This is where the process macro that we're going to work with today starts to facilitate things. And I put together a publication where we made an argument for a mediated moderation model. It didn't actually take out, but I had to do it in M plus a lot of different coding and sort of gymnastics and trying to figure things out. Hayes is taking care of this for you. Make it easier for you to do it. You just want to make sure you know what you're doing to do things correctly with this. Okay. And then finally, we see that measurement error in the mediator can result in underestimation of the rich relation with both x and y. Okay. We're saying x relates to y. And this is the one and only mediator in the universe, right? This is the thing that causes that, but our measure of our mediator is crappy, right? It's just got a lot of air, right? And if we have air in our mediator, what's it going to do to this relationship? Make it weaker. What is it going to do to that relationship? It's going to make it weaker, right? These two variables we measured well, right? So we still got a strong relationship here. This indirect effect is just weak because we've got a crappy measure, right? What we end up with is a violation of our basic assumptions of regression, because this is an IV, and we're assuming our IVs are measured without error, but we don't, because it's got error, we always have error in here. But again, one of these things is going to start to cause problems, yeah.
So is it not possible to have a mediated mediation, because then that would just be a third variable?
No, you can put together whatever path model you want. It gets really complicated and fun. If you go through and take a look.
Is that where SCM comes in?
Or this process model, right?
Oh, okay.
So mediated mediation. That's a perfectly fine model, right? You're just saying that the relation this relation is mediated to this, and this is actually mediated to that, and then you go through that rabbit hole, take it down into infinity, if your theoretical model will support these contentions, right? And so it's not just words sort of saying this and this and this and this. We can start to get incredibly elaborate models, and again, these previously you could do with a regression analysis, but it's hard and you gotta do a bunch of stuff. SEM is more flexible, they're able to go through and do this, but Hayes has gone through and figured out a lot of the math for you and sort of streamlined the output so we can start to get increasingly complex models and run these in SAS and SPSS. And again, anybody, are SAS users in here? Like native SAS users?
You have.
You have, but it's not, but you
can
bring it. Okay. So again, if you go down through or shoot me an email, you can run this process. They've got a SAS workbook as well, so you can do that. Okay. But we'll get into some of that. But partial mediation, people understand what's going on with this? Okay. Causal steps approach. This is a classic approach to testing the mediation model that we continue to do up until recently. We'll go through and talk about it. But I will say, at this point in time, there's no reason for you to run a causal steps model unless you've got like a really good a reason for it. We have better methods than this, and you shouldn't be using them at this point if you've got a project that comes up like this. But for a conceptual standpoint, so you understand what's going on with this, causal steps analysis. We're going to run a couple different regression models here. First analysis, first step, we're going to regress X on Y to establish that we have effectively mediated, right? In a very simple, simplest circumstance, do we need to run a regression model, see if we have a relation dependence, or do we just take a correlation, right? But in terms of how we're going to go through and calculate our indirect effects here, need to regress Y onto X so that you have a coefficient there that you go through and take a look at, okay? Easy peasy. Second, right, what we're going to do is we're going to regress our mediator onto our X to demonstrate a relation between the mediator and our X value. So we're taking care of path A here. Right, so again, in the most basic case, right, these are just two initial bivariate regression models, right? Regressing X onto Y in step one, we get a coefficient for our C path. We regress mediator onto our X to get A path. And then what we do is we're going to regress Y onto both X and our mediator to establish a unique relation between our outcome and our mediator above and beyond stuff that's going on here, okay? This is giving us our B path. So within this third step, we get the relation between our mediator outcome controlling for X, right? And if our mediator is actually our mechanism, we should see a strong relationship there, right? Like, X is kind of inconsequential. It's just something that happened further along in the chain. This is the direct effect, and this is the direct cause of Y. So we should see a reliable relationship here in our B path. So again, so insufficient to examine the association of outcome on mediator independently, as we would expect Y and our mediator should both be a consequence of X, right? So X is an important variable. We're not just going to regress Y onto our mediator in the absence of X. X needs to be in there because it's part of the causal chain, right? And again, the shared association has to be included when we're determining our path to be in there. Okay. So three models. We're going to go through and we're going to regress Y under our predictor, right? Get our C path. Then our next model, we're going to regress our mediator under our predictor to establish our A path. And then our third model, we're going to regress A on both our mediator and our X. And the relation between our mediator and our outcome is going to be our B path. But we still want to go through and we want to make sure that X is in there and controlled. And then in that third regression model, that C prime path, that's going to be the residual relation between X and our outcome after we control for the variable in the model. So by our third model, we get our start by getting our C. In our second model, we get A. In our third model, we get a coefficient for both B and C prime. People following me up to this point? Okay. And then what we need to do is we need to determine whether or not our mediator can do a full mediation. If the relation between X and Y operating control for our mediator is completely gone, then technically we claim that we have full mediation, right? But if we have a non-zero CPAP, what we might then say is perhaps we have what we might call partial mediation. So when we regress X on a mediator or Y on a mediator and X, we get a significant relation here, but this C prime path is still statistically reliable. What we want to do is determine whether or not we have enough of a decrease in that in order to claim partial mediation. Okay? People following me up to this? Right? So we're not creating interaction terms and simple slopes. And like, it's easy. It's nice. It's easy. It's straightforward. You're just looking at regression coefficients and some models. Okay? So, but now what we've got is a problem here on how to. So what's our test, what's our criteria for establishing whether or not that reduction of C to C prime is enough to claim the evidence of partial mediation, right? And so basically what we're doing, our main effect here is looking at the difference between the bivariate relation and then the residual relation here, so the reduction of C to C prime. But from a mathematical standpoint, we end up saying that in this bivariate case, C minus C prime is the same thing as AB. Remember that in this case, we're working with our unstandardized coefficients. Don't try and plug standardized coefficients in here. That'll screw you up, right? But we see is that this indirect effect of X on Y through our mediator, the product of this A and B path, is mathematically equivalent to C minus C prime. So, in our regression models, you can calculate your indirect effect to be tested, right, in a couple of different ways. You can take the regression coefficient for X in the initial path and subtract it from the coefficient for X in the path that has a mediator in it and just calculate C minus C prime that way. Or you can take the relation, the coefficient for the relation between X and mediator in your second model and then multiply it by the relation for your mediator and your outcome. The other model, take your B and your C path, multiply it together, you're going to get the same coefficient that in the center on the error types of things. Okay? Mathematically equivalent. Okay? And so the total effect of X on Y is going to be the sum of all your direct and your error paths. So if you take the product of path A multiplied by path B, and then add in the residual path here, what should that coefficient do for you? Exactly. Yeah, so if I've got X, I've got Y, I've got my mediator, right? And this is A, this is B, and this is C, and then I've got C prime, right? If I take the product of A and B and add in C prime, what value should I get? You get C, right? This should all sum to zero. It has to, and determine the output, right? And again, because this is the total relation in your data between X and Y, we can go through and take a look at this and this and add that in. We're going to get that value right there. This gets into sort of this concept of tracing rules and things that start to become relevant when you get into different types of structural equation modeling and things of that nature. Okay? So the question is whether or not there's C minus C prime or equivalently AB, whether or not that's a statistically reliable number, right? Is this value reliably different than zero, okay? If we want to test if something is reliably different than zero, what do we need? Jack? Always need a standard error, of course, right? We're going to do this. One, we need a standard error, and then we need to know theoretically what that distribution should look like, right? And so a classic approach to looking at partial mediation, we want to go through and get some estimate of a standard error for C minus C prime. Now, the problem is the distribution of C minus C prime under the null hypothesis is kind of complex. But Sobel put together an approximation of this, and so what we do is we can derive an estimated standard error to test C minus C prime, or alternatively AB, however you want to calculate that, by taking your unstandardized coefficient, B coefficient here, multiplying it by the standard error of A, taking the square of the square of your A coefficient, and multiplying it by the standard error for your coefficient of B, minus the square of the square of your standard error for A, times the standard error for B. Right? Take all that, take the square root of that, and what we do is we take that standard error, divide it by our AB or our C minus C prime, however we want to put that together, and that approximately falls along a Z distribution. Okay. So, I mean, it looks kind of like an SE, but it's actually not terrible, right? So what we're doing, we're in our model 1, model 2, model 3, and then we just hijack coefficients out of model 1, model 2, model 3, to then derive a standard error for our C minus C prime estimate, and take that, and again, it's a Z distribution, so we have to worry about degrees of freedom, critical value, to determine critical value? No, right? If we're alpha is P equal 0.05, our critical value for our Z is 1.96. Right? And you often see people say it's less than 2, but it's 1.96. If we get a test statistic, a Z is greater than 1.96, we claim evidence for partial mediation. If it's not, we can say, well, this indirect path, this indirect A path, or the reduction of C minus C prime isn't sufficiently large enough to provide the square.
Mm-hmm.
Square
root of
the
square, is that correlation between the correlation between the other?
Remember, with this, all we're working with are unstandardized coefficients. Right? So you take the square of your unstandardized coefficient and multiply it by the square of the standard error for the coefficient here. Take the square of this coefficient, multiply it by the standard error for this, and the square, subtract that by the square of those two standard errors, and then get to an approximation of that Sobel test. Questions? All right. McKinnon and Dwyer further suggest sort of giving some sort of index of the magnitude of mediation as a percentage of the total effect. This makes some sense, right? So if A and B is your indirect effect, right? That's the indirect relation of X on Y through M, right? That's a nice way to talk about it in terms of language, right? AB represents the indirect relation of X and Y, X on Y through M. But if we take that and we divide it by AB plus C prime, again, Zach, what does that represent? Yeah, your total effect, right? So it's the partial effect over the total effect, and this you can interpret this as a proportion of percentage of mediation, right? So we might say that based on this, we still have a significant C prime value, but it looks like based on McKinnon and Dwyer's metric, we would say that our mediator accounts for 60% of the 60% of the relation between X and Y. So we got partial mediation. So you can start to go through, because with a very large sample, right, you could get a reliable indirect relation of X on Y through M. It might be very small, right? It might be a really small indirect effect. And so maybe that mediator accounts for only 10% of that relation, not the variability. So make sure you're not saying that, right? We're accounting for, this is a proportion of the total relation given, right? So this mediator is accounting for 20% of the total effect of X on Y, right? But again, you can take a look, pretty easy, straightforward ratio, it makes some sense. You just got four accounted for over the total, and go through and include that in your interpretation of the mediation model. Questions? All right. So let's go through one time. All right, let's take a break right now, and when we get back, we'll jump into running through the regression model. This won't take too long. All right, so example we're going to run through, and again, this is pulled from a paper that I had run where we were able to sneak this by. It was a good paper. Probably one of my favorite papers. I think we had a good conceptual argument, but it is a mediation model. I try to be tricky and call it an intervening variable model. I'm not sort of saying mediation, but mediation is causation. But so the interesting thing, so the question is, does attitude towards support utilization account for the relation between post-trauma symptoms and social support. This idea that within trauma survivors, particularly those who are experiencing active symptoms, things like sort of shifts in world assumptions, right? Sort of starting to think that maybe people aren't trustworthy, the world is dangerous, and things along those lines. We know that post-trauma symptoms are strongly correlated with, or have, not strongly, but has a consistent correlation with perceived support, right? And so the question here is that perceived support, so the idea being that from a stress buffering model, that people who have lots of support are less likely to get PTSD. What we did is look this around and say, well, there's a lot of things that are active about active post-trauma symptoms that might start to push people away, right? And so is it possible that sort of this reluctance to utilize support resources, is that actually driving some of the relation between post-trauma symptoms and reduced perception of social support, right? Because it doesn't matter, you've got all the support resources around you. If you refuse to engage those support resources, they're not going to be helpful, right? And so in this case, PTSD is our predictor, social support is our outcome, and then this willingness to utilize support stuff is going to be our belief. Okay? So what we've got is our conceptual model here. Have our data set up and running. So we've got our participant number, our perceived social support, our willingness to utilize support, and then our post-trauma scores. We could, if we wanted to, go through and calculate a centered variable, right? So we go so now, what's our first model that we're going to run here, Gary?
We're going to regress. Wait. So the ACAP is.
Not going to look at. We're not going to start with ACAP. That would make some sense given it's A, but what's the first model we're gonna run?
I guess the CPAP.
CPAP, right?
Yeah.
We're gonna sort of verify that there's a relation to be mediated, right? And so we're gonna go through and look at perceived support, and we're gonna regress perceived support on PTSD, and then just because I'd like to ask for part and partial correlations and paste that in our syntax file. Okay? So here's our we can identify this as what's the next model that we need to run?
I'm trying to catch up. So
RISC-M1X.
RISC-M1X, right, which gives us our A pad. So in this case, we enter the address our utilization path onto PTSD. That's going to give us our A pad. And then finally, what's going to give us our last model? Judah, what are we going to get here?
Now we're going to do regress Y on M and X.
Exactly. So we're going to take our support, we're going to regress that onto PTSD and utilization, and that's our model. Right. So, and again, these are all contained on your handout, so don't worry too much if you're not completely up to speed with some of this. But we then go through and run our models. And take a look at our first one, all right? Sean, tell me what we're seeing in this first model here. Perfect. Only thing I would change, we said we're only accounting for about 9% of variability outcome. Okay, yeah. But again, in the bivariate case, right, if I were to take 0.303, what would I and square it, what would I get? 0.09, right? Because in the bivariate case, our standardized beta is the same thing as our partial correlation, our partial on zero order, is the same thing as our multiple R, and we square that all. This has just got the one variable, one predictor in the model, right? But if we're looking at this, we see that our overall ANOVA, and if we take that F and we take the square root of that, we're going to get that T, right? So it all, everything's working together in relative harmony here. Yeah.
Just a quick conceptual question. Mm-hmm. So what we're saying is that as PTSD symptoms increase, mm-hmm. social support decreases.
Exactly.
And you were saying that's because sometimes some of the things that happen, like the presentations of PTSD, push people away.
That was the argument we made in this paper, right? So things like sort of feeling detached and sort of having flat affect, mm-hmm. or sort of having irritability, sort of being on guard, hypervigilant all the time, being avoiding because I don't want to go out and do things. Mm-hmm. These types of things in sort of this model, sort of taking that stress buffering model and changing it around, saying like, hey, maybe there's stuff that go on that sort of makes it difficult to sort of engage support mm-hmm. systems for people who are experiencing active symptoms, right? Trent, what is my CPAP here? The one that we're going to use and be excited about? Which one's the coefficient? Perfect. Remember, we're always working with our standardized coefficients. You'll have, it seems like it might make some sense to use our standardized coefficients. It doesn't. You'll plug the standardized coefficients into your calculations. This is particularly confusing given that basically our beta is an anagram of our unstandardized coefficient, right? That's just in this case, right? So just this is our C path that we're going to target, right? So. This as beta, this I would use just a lowercase b. Okay. It just sort of helps differentiate. They use uppercase b. What you don't want to do is sort of, this should be beta as in degree, sort of beta, not sort of standardized.
That's what I was wondering, is the standardized for degree?
Yeah. Exactly. Okay. Question, yeah?
Just to clarify, when we're doing this, it's okay if we run each level in a block, like next block and do it again, and do like hierarchy?
No, that won't work. Why is that? why can't we run this in like a hierarchical model? Yeah, our DB changes, right? Because in the next model, we're regressing our mediator onto our X, right? So we can't run that in a hierarchical model because our outcome's different. Right? And so we do run that though, so we've got, we're regressing our mediator, in this case, support utilization, onto PTSD. Again, same situation, it's a bivariate regression, right? So our zero partial part is all the same as our R squared, right? But it looks like for these variables, PTSD is accounted for about 19% of variability in utilization of willingness to utilize support resources. That's statistically significant. We go down through, we see our unstandardized coefficient, our standardized coefficient, and we see a reliable effect here. And so Candace, what's my coefficient for, what path is this, and where do I find the coefficient that I'm gonna use?
This is the C path.
Okay. Is this a C path? Yeah, C path in the first model, right?
This is the C prime path.
Okay. We haven't got to C prime yet.
This is what you'll use to get to the C.
Not quite. What's the path we're looking at here, Trent? A path. Okay. So we've taken our mediator, support utilization, regressed it onto PTSD. Right? So our first model gets our C path, right?
Mm-hmm.
Regress our outcome onto our predictor. This demonstrates
that
we have a path to be mediated. What we do in our second model is establish that we do in fact have a relation between our mediator and our outcome. Because if that doesn't hold, our mediator is not a plausible mechanism because X doesn't have no relationship with it, right? And so here we're getting our A path, right? And so our A path is going to be 12.251. Again, remembering that we're using our unstandardized regression coefficients here. Okay. So we've established that X is related to our outcome. We've established that X is related to our mediator, right? What do we do next, Zach? So in our last model, what we're going to do is we're going to regress our outcome, which is perceived support, onto both our X variable and our mediator. Okay? So we're taking perceived support, we're regressing that onto PTSD and our support utilization, right? And we get an R squared where these two variables, the best linear combination of PTSD and support utilization is accounted for about 28.4% of the variability in perceived support. That's pretty reasonable, right? We would expect that to be a statistically reliable effect. Our F statistic says yes, it is, right? So we've got a model that is some value that's reliably not equal to zero, right? And so we're going to go down through, and now we've got two coefficients here. Okay, Judah, tell me what my two coefficients represent in terms of our model. What is this coefficient here? What does that represent in terms of this? What path is that?
That's path B.
Perfect.
And it's your mediator to your outcome of actual social support.
Right.
Um,
what about this coefficient?
And that's going to be your C prime.
Okay. And what does that represent?
That represents the relation of PTSD to social support with our mediator in the mix as well.
Right. So this is the unique relation between PTSD and outcome after we account for support utilization. Right? So at this point, we've got our A path, we've got our B path, we've got our C prime, and we've got our C. Okay? And so, and in interpreting this, technically, what is our conclusion based on this model? Lucy?
Well,
based on this final model, like what is our conclusion in terms of whether or not supportive utilization mediates the relation between our X, our PTSD, and social support?
Our conclusion is that there is a partial mediation of utilization on the relation between PTSD and social support.
Okay, you could say that. What makes you say it's partial mediation?
Because our C-prime's not zero. I mean, it's small as hell, but it's not zero.
Well, remember that these are unstandardized coefficients,
okay.
So we won't sort of make too much of that magnitude. Now, our standardized coefficient is still pretty small,
yeah.
Right? Could we make a claim for full mediation?
I think so.
Yeah, what does that do?
Because it's no longer significant when I believe the relation was significant to begin with.
So our CPAP that was statistically reliable is no longer statistically reliable. So you could make an argument that we have full mediation and call it a day. That's a standardized coefficient. Our partial correlation here is consistent with a small effect, right? And so it's depending on, we've got a pretty big sample, right? If we're not getting a reliable relation with 300 people. But, you know, and for the purposes of sort of demonstrating this, let's say that we'll call this margin, let's say that we want to go through and just make extra sure that the reduction from C to C prime, or by contrast, the product of our A and our B paths are statistically reliable using our Sobel approximation. Okay? So again, really, you could make a claim for full mediation,
right?
But we'll go through and go through the test. Okay? People see where that's coming from? Okay. So, and this will be easier because we can't fit everything on the screen, so rely on it. Yeah.
Okay, so what Judah is just saying, that because that that relation between PTSD and social support went from being significant to no longer significant once we're on the full model,
mm-hmm.
That's why we can argue that it's a full mediation?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it could be the case in something else that it would still be significant, but our C prime was also significant, and that would be partial?
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. Now, we're not C prime. If C prime is statistically significant, that's when we're in a partial mediation type of thing, right? What we're testing here is the indirect relation of right. If our C prime, right, was still statistically reliable, then sort of our question is it dropped down? It's still not zero, but is it dropped down enough for us to claim mediation?
Okay.
Yeah.
And some kind of R-squared change that we can look at, or how do you determine the enough that it's dropped?
How do we determine whether it's enough? At least in this, the way that we don't do it anymore, shouldn't do it anymore, but could do it, we used to do it, our Sobel test, right? We go through and retest this, right? So, if our indirect path, either AB or C minus C prime, how do we go through and start calculating that? Let's calculate AB first, because that's probably what we're going to end up doing anyway. What's my coefficient for A? Wonderful. We got 0.251 times, what's our B coefficient?
-0.084.
Okay. And if we multiply those out, we get a coefficient of -0.021. By contrast, if we take, someone tell me what our C coefficient was. 0.030, and what was my C prime?
-0.009.
If I take those two things should be subtract that, right? I get the same thing, right? 0.021. Right?
If I take point 030 and I subtract negative point 009, same thing, right? So again, just to establish that these two things are functionally equivalent. Mathematically, they're the same thing. It doesn't matter if we're talking about C minus C prime versus A times B. Classic approach to causal steps mediation, the primary focus is on the reduction of this C path. Do we see a substantial reduction from C minus to C prime? But as we start to go through more contemporary approaches to assessing intervening variable models, we're gonna put more of a focus on not worrying about whether or not this decreases. We're just more interested, this is what we're actually interested in, right? We're just using C minus C prime as a way to go through and sort of test in this old school approach, right? What we're really interested in is the indirect effect of X on Y through M, right? And so AB from a conceptual standpoint is more consistent with the effect that we're actually interested in versus the reduction of C to C prime, but mathematically they're the same. All right, so what do we need to do now? So we've got our indirect, this is our coefficient for our indirect effect. What do we need to do now?
We need standard error.
Right, we need our standard error, okay? So our standard error is gonna be, all right, we're gonna take our B path, squared B, into negative 0.084, squared times our standard error for our A path, which is going to be 0.030 squared. Okay. You'll see where I'm getting that?
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to add the square of our A path and do 0.251 squared times the standard error for our B path squared. Okay. And then we're going to add to that, square my standard error for my A path, 0.030.
Is that minus?
What's that?
That last one is minus.
Oh, is it minus? Thank you. I make that error. Minus 0.003 times 0.009 squared. It's going to be an increasingly smaller number, right? This is why you need to either use Excel or a graphing calculator and keep storing the stuff in there in order to get things, because otherwise if you try and round it for different decimal places, you're going to be way off base, right? So if we go 0.084 squared and 0.030 squared, multiply that, we take 0.251 squared, 0.009 squared, multiply that, 0.030 squared, 0.009 squared, multiply that, and add those first two and then say 0.030 squared, 0.009 squared, multiply, subtract. I'm getting 0.00011 down. It's an incredibly small number. Then we want to take the square root of that. And we get a standard error of 0.0034. So again, we're working with very small numbers, so to the extent to which you can save those in your calculator and just use those instead of trying to round stuff out, you're gonna be better off, right? So this is our standard error. So what do we now need to do in order to test whether or not we have a reliable reduction in C to C prime, or alternatively, whether this indirect effect from A to B is statistically reliable?
Take your AB divided by the standard error we just got.
Exactly, right? It's like we always talk about, we've got a coefficient divided by our standard error. So z is negative 0.021 over 0.0034, roughly speaking. And so if we go to 0.021, get that around, because z z-score equal to 6.22, something around there. Is that a reliable effect?
Yeah,
right.
Critical value for z is gonna be 1.96, so, and we knew that, right? So this is just a process to take you through how we go through that SOREL estimation. What's the, maybe the one final thing that we might want to test for this? Or statistic we talked about? Percent mediation, right? And so percent mediation is gonna be our indirect effect, which is 0.021 over what? What's the denominator of this? AB, and what is AB plus C prime? What's that? It's equal to C, right? So our C is, .030. We take 0.021 divided by 0.030. We get 0.79. And so what we can say is we can go through, and this would be most appropriate or if that C prime path was still statistically reliable. Technically, we could say we don't need to go through this whole rigmarole because we went from a reliable association that now is no longer reliable. We have full mediation. But I don't know, it's being lazy because it's clear that it's not completely gone, right? So when we go through, calculate this, we get a clearly statistically reliable test statistic. So we would, in this case, claim, so say we find evidence to support, for support of a reliable indirect relation of X on Y through our mediator, corresponding to a test statistic of 6.22, it's gonna be P less than 0.001. And then what we would do is we would take our indirect effect, take it over the total effect, and say that in this case, based on these data, we would estimate that willingness to utilize support resources accounts for about 70% of the relation between, about 70% of the effect of PTSD on a reduction in perceived support. How are people feeling about this? Pretty straightforward, like relative to moderation, this is a cakewalk, right? I mean, maybe I have to run through some numbers there and do some things, but at the end of the day, this is not too bad, right?
You made a pun, you didn't even realize it.
What's up?
You said, this is a cakewalk. I mean, maybe you'll have to run through.
Right. Gotcha. I did that on purpose. That's the Easter egg I hid in this week's video. Questions about this process, how we derive the SOREL, anything like that? Okay. So that's our basic causal steps approach, which is where we were at for some considerable amount of time. But we've had some updates, things have gotten better, and we've also gone through and recognized that we have some limitations to this causal steps approach. It's good, but it has some drawbacks, okay? We can't, there's a number of reasons why you can't draw strong inferences from this causal steps approach. One, our experimental designs are probably more rigorous tests, right? And again, Josh in here, and anytime we try to mention something about causality, you get very up in arms about things, right? Very difficult to establish causal relationships. Even within the context of experimental designs. Experimental designs are a little more rigorous. We can start to control external factors. We can start to actively manipulate the mediator to determine whether or not this is actually causing the effect that we would like. But it's difficult to establish this in correlation with designs. Okay? If we use longitudinal assessment, right, it's helping out, but temporal precedence in and of itself isn't enough to establish causality, right? Just because X preceded Y doesn't mean that X caused Y. It helps us clear out the possibility that Y caused X, but it's still
difficult to start to make the strong claim for X as a causal agent of Y. Are correlation data useful for determining plausibility of mediation pathways, but difficult to say in the absence of an experiment that this is X causing Y, that type of thing, right? And so this is why anytime you say mediation, it implies causality. We don't talk about it that way, but that's really what we're saying, and that we're not saying, right? And so this is why it's incredibly difficult to put together a strong mediation model with just using correlation data. We can run the analyses all day long, right? But it's just very hard to make a strong argument that yes, this is why empirically, sort of say, if we don't have temporal precedence or anything like that, we start to get into a very sticky conceptual argument for why this model versus something else. Okay. Some limitations, even within the basic assumptions of our causal model. Causal model approach sort of says that we need to have a significant relation between X and Y before we go through and jump into our mediation model, right? And conceptually this makes sense because if X isn't related to Y, why are you talking about a mediator if X isn't related to Y? When we get into applied analysis, we start to get into some difficulty with this from a couple different standpoints. If X and Y are measured reasonably close to one another, again, we're saying that if we're doing a good study where we're not measuring everything together, right? But I measure X, then I measure Y at some other close in time, we should have a relation between X and Y. X should be reasonably related to Y, okay? But as this causal process becomes more distal, we may start to see a reduction in X and Y, right? So if I go through and I measure your achievement today as a third grader, and then measure something else down the road as you're an adult, that's a long time for stuff to go through, even if there is, at the population level, if we were to measure everything without error, a relation with X and Y, we start to have problems going on in the actual practice of measuring that relation. We have transmission of this process to other stuff, other things are going on. We have multiple mediators that are coming on and creating relations. We have other competing things going through. We have random error. And so if we're measuring things distal, right, we may not find a reliable relation between X and Y, between two things that conceptually we have strong arguments should be related. Okay. And so this becomes difficult to detect this causal relation, and sometimes sort of our statistical models are better powered to detect sort of distal mediation processes than they are to detect the direct effect of X on Y. Okay. So what can happen? So let's say a case where A and B are consistent with median effects. So the standardized relation between A, standardized relation between B is 0.30. Okay. And if I have a sample of 80, that gives me adequate power to detect our mediation path, right? So if I take 0.3 times 0.3, give me a standardized effect of 0.09, right? If I've got 80 people in my sample, I can detect mediation path here, and I can test mediation path here, right? But assuming 100% mediation, that would mean that if for example, so X, a long time until we get to Y, right? Here's M, right? I might find, and if M completely mediates this, right? And this is 0.30, this is 0.30, right? And my C prime path is equal to 0.0, right? So this mediator completely mediates this relationship, right? With 80 people in my second model, I can test this and have enough power to detect this relation. In my third model, I have enough power to detect this relation. Right? But overall, in my first model, when I'm trying to establish that initial relation, I'm looking at my C path is equal to 0.09, that's a small effect, right? Technically, I need 966 people to reliably detect, have adequate power to detect this relationship, right? And so what can happen is I can establish this, and I can establish this, but I may not even get that far because I've got, I wasn't able to establish that initial relation between X and Y because it's a very, very small effect, okay? And so this is why it starts to become problematic. If you say, we cannot move forward with our mediation analysis unless we demonstrate a reliable effect of X on Y, we're gonna be missing some stuff, both for conceptual reasons, because if they're distally measured, there's a lot of other stuff that can go on. And statistically, we may not have the power to detect this relationship. It's there, but it's just fully mediated by this. We can detect this, but we didn't even get there if we, on the first one, we say, we need X to be related to Y. We didn't get there. We didn't find a reliable effect. We found an effect of 0.09, but our p-value for that is 0.2 or something like that, right? Makes it difficult to move forward, okay? So people see sort of why, if we're sort of putting a strict say, like we need to have a statistically reliable effect between X and Y, why that can be problematic, okay? Other thing that can go on in establishing this operating effect, Schrott and Boulder. Have people read these papers? Read these papers, important to go through and read these papers. What we ended up having is suppressor effects that occur when indirect effect of AB has the opposite of direct effects. Okay? This is a different type of suppressor effect than we talked about. These are using the same term with a different type of thing. But let's say, consider a case where coping behavior is our mediator, is activated by environmental stress, which is expected to hold a positive relation to psychological stress. So, we're saying that environmental stress, so the stress that you're going through, expects to hold a positive relation with psychological distress. So as your stress level goes up, your psychological distress goes up, right? So we're expecting, but we're looking at whether the extent to which your coping behavior mediates the relationship between the amount of stress you're going and the level of psychological discomfort. In this case, we can have environmental stress and coping expected to have a positive relation, right? As my stress goes up, I would expect my coping efforts to go up, right? Makes some sense, right? We would also expect coping and psychological distress to have a negative relation. Right? So our path B, as my coping goes up, my psychological distress should go down. And so as a consequence, if we take this positive coefficient multiplied by that negative coefficient, our indirect path is going to be negative. Okay? But because the total effect of X on Y is equal to this product plus C prime, what we might end up with is a near zero bivariate correlation if this indirect path here is about the same as the positive relation here. Right? So X and Y, or the positive, the residual path here between X and Y is positive, but then if we count in the negative relation here, what ends up happening is the total effect may be very close to zero if these two things cancel each other out. Right? So in this case, we have path A is, say, negative 0.30. Positive 0.30, right? Path B is negative 0.30, right? And my C prime is going to be okay. So let's say that my path A is positive 0.3, path B is negative 0.3, that gives me AB equal to negative 0.09, right? If the positive relation between stress and environmental stress and psychological distress, if what's left over is about its positive relation, right? But it's still correlated, the positive relationship's about 0.09, because our total effect is AB plus C prime, we get negative 0.09 plus 0.09. My direct effect is going to be 0. And so what can happen here is just statistically the way this variance goes through, what we can have is have our indirect cancel out our residual, sort of be at the same level as whatever our residual is left over. And so if we just look at the correlation between x and y in these variables, my correlation is going to be 0, right? It doesn't mean that x isn't related to y. It's just the indirect effect is offset by the residual positive relationship there. And from a statistical standpoint, I'm getting the zero relationship between these two variables. Okay. So again, total effect here, and this is something that can come up, and again, if we're not thinking about what these models are and how they work and things along those lines, if I'm giving myself the requirement that I need to establish a relation between x and y before I move forward with things, just the way my variables fit together, I might end up with a bivariate correlation between these two things that's zero, even though there's a very clear indirect relation going on here. Okay. People just kind of see how this is working out. Okay. And so some recommendations on how to address some of these things. One, we should hope for a direct effect of x on y. If you've got a relation, if x and y are related, it's going to make your life a whole lot easier. Okay. And if you have some reasonable, if x and y are estimated or measured closely in time, you should probably have a relation between x and y, or at least something from the literature to suggest that x and y should be related, right, before we move forward. But if you have a situation or an assumption of a relation between x and y, one, if you've got a longitudinal design and your predictor is measured a long time before your final outcome, we might start to relax this a little bit and say, okay, well, it's a long distal process. I only have so many research dollars to follow someone in 3 years. It's not a big, massive amount, right? So I'm going to go through and conceptually answer some methodological aspects of this. I'm giving up the benefit of measuring everything at the same time, and so I'm going to go through and start to relax sort of this demand that I have a strong or a statistically reliable relation on the front end. If I were to affect subtle effects of x on y, okay, complete mediation with modest samples, right? Getting back up to here, x on y should be kind of related, right? So it's, I mean, not kind of related, but sort of have a modest relationship here. I don't have a big sample sort of coming back on here. Maybe we start to relax. And I say, all right, it looks like there's a small relation between x and y. I don't know, x and y, from a theoretical standpoint, should be functionally related to one another. I don't have that many people, so I'm going to go ahead and proceed with my mediation analyses, even though I don't have that established effect. And then three, if we have, if we suspect that there may be what Trout and Bolger are calling suppression effects going on in the model. This is different than the suppression effects you talked about, right? You're just expecting the AB effects to have an opposite sign of about equal magnitude as your C, this should be C prime. That's going to render your C path close to zero anyway, right? So we want to think about these things. Okay. People understand sort of why, in general, establishing a significant relation between x and y is going to be your best bet. It's going to give you the best and strongest ground to stand on moving forward. But in cases, under certain circumstances, we might not just start getting there and say, I'm going to continue to move forward with this, even though we don't have this base relation here. So other thing that we have going on with causal effects stuff, some problems with the estimation of our standard errors. Okay? Classic approach to testing the significance of mediated effects, we have problems with this Sobel estimate of our standard error. Okay? What ends up happening is a sampling distribution of this AB statistic, right? The sampling distribution of our indirect effect isn't normal, okay? And so when we go through and we derive a Sobel standard error that's predicated on the normal theory for the normal distribution, because we're testing it against a Z distribution. Z distribution is normal, right? But what we know is the empirical distribution of AB isn't normal, right? So what we're doing is we're taking a standard error estimate that assumes a normal theory distribution, and we're using that distribution along to test an effect that we know doesn't have a normal distribution. It's an approximation, right? So we start to get biases. If we go through and we ran a simulation of the distribution of AB, this is what the distribution of AB looks like versus the normal theory that we're testing it against. In certain cases, if we have a positive indirect effect, positive skew, negative indirect, negative skew. And so what ends up happening is when we test these indirect effects, this AB coefficient, or conversely C minus C prime, if we test this with Sobel, what ends up happening is we have inflated type 2 error. Gavin, what happens if we have inflated type 2 error? What's going to happen? What's the impact on our inverts? What's going to happen?
We're not catching
something. Yeah.
So that's not impacting our
inverts. Yeah, right. We're going to fail to reject the null, right? More often than we should under sort of like the assumptions of our distribution are, right? Too much of the time we're going to be forced to fail to claim a reliable indirect effect when we probably should, right? And so again, this starts to, we have problems with our Sobel effect, or with type 2 error with Sobel, in all cases except for when we have very, very large samples. If you've got really massive samples, then we have less of a problem with Sobel, but we're psychologists, and so we're often not working with large samples. Or if we're looking with very large effects, right? If the indirect effect of X on Y through M is quite large, then we're good. But given what you know about effect sizes in psychological science, we're generally working with small to medium effects, right? And if we're looking at AB as a product of two medium effects, that's probably looking at a small effect, right? And so we start to have problems with Sobel in terms of different approaches, right? We have some variants on Sobel in terms of certain play around with the calculation of that equation, sort of trying to make adjustments, some improvement, but we still end up being limited here. So, in addition to sort of conceptually needing to have this reliable relation between X and Y to start with, the test of our significance of our partial mediation, it's all right, but the statistical model doesn't actually map onto what's actually going on, so we start to get biases resulting in unpowered tests. Okay? So we're going to fail to reject the null hypothesis more often than we should. Okay. And so the corresponding confidence intervals for our AB also perform poorly, given that we have biases in our standard error here. Oh, is that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this.
Okay, thank you. Can you email me to change that?
Oh.
Okay, yeah, make a note of that. We're talking about inflated type 2 error. We have, we're not claiming statistical significance as much as we should be with this. So, thank you. Okay. So, solution is we step away from normal theory stuff and start looking at empirical distributions to derive our standard errors. And one of the approaches, if you go through and read those articles that I assigned, one of the approaches that's working the best is starting to go through and derive bootstrap standard errors for this indirect effect, okay? Bootstrapping a resampling procedure. And what we're doing is instead of working with a theoretical distribution, we just create a distribution and then derive our estimates from there. Okay. So what is going on with the bootstrap procedure to derive our standard errors? What we do we take our original data, all right, we use our sample, and we use this as the population, right? And what we do is we create a bootstrap sample of n cases drawn randomly with replacement. So if I have a sample of 300, right, and these 300 scores, I'm going to treat that as my population. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go through and I'm going to take a random sample of 300 cases from that, but I'm doing it with replacement, right? So my bootstrap sample, I might have the same person in there 10 times because I'm going through pulling someone, putting everybody back, pulling through, getting someone back. And so my bootstrap sample is going to be different than my population sample. Yes?
How's it different from your population sample if you're using the same n size?
Right. Let's say, in theoretical, so I have to deal with a situation, I've got a sample of 200 people, mm-hmm. right? And Carl is one of those 200 people. I could conceivably, and if I did this long enough, would eventually get a sample that was just Carl's score sampled 200 times. And so my bootstrap sample would be sort of far as the end of the spectrum. Carl's in my sample 150 times, and then the other 50 scores in the sample are sort of other people that managed to pick up.
So it randomly selects a case, not the full.
No. So I've got 200 people, right? I'm going to go through and I'm going to randomly pull out a score and say, all right, this is my first person in my bootstrap sample, and then take that person and throw it back in, mm-hmm. right? And then do another one, maybe I do another person, another person, another person.
Oh.
But I could get the same person
right.
6, 7, 10 billion times in that bootstrap sample. So every bootstrap sample is going to be unique because it's going to be a true random drawing of the population of scores.
Gotcha.
Does that help?
Yes.
Okay.
You.
And so what we're going to do is we're going to do this. And so I'm going to draw a bootstrap sample with replacement from my sample of 200 people. I'm going to draw a new sample with replacement of 200 people. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to estimate AB for that bootstrap sample. And then I'm going to do this again. And then I'm going to do it again. And I'm going to do it again for however many times I tell the program to go through and do this, right? And so what we do is we go through again, draw a sample, estimate AB, and then we do that again for, let's say, 5,000 replication samples. And then what I do is I plot out the distribution of AB across those 5,000 replications, and then I use that to derive standard errors and confidence intervals for that indirect effect. Right? So the standard deviation of the sampling distribution of AB, that's my estimate of my population standard error. Right? So what I do is I go through let's say this is my distribution of A and B, right? I do this 5,000 times, and this is the distribution of my estimates for A and B, right? Now, then what I do for my standard error is I just take the standard deviation of my sampling distribution, and I derive myself an empirically derived standard error for that. Because that's what standard error is, right? Standard error is just the standard deviation of your sampling distribution. Mm-hmm. This time, this is what we're doing here, instead of having access to the entire population, what we're doing is just we're using my scores and my data as the population to derive an empirical distribution, and then just pulling my standard error directly from that, right? And so what we end up doing is that given that we have some skew in our sampling distribution for AB, confidence interval that we derive can be asymmetrical. A number of different ways to do this, but our simulation research suggests that some bias-corrected bootstrap methods is just an adjustment to just using the raw standard deviation of my sample distribution and my standard error, going through some adjustments and looking at how this performs, and it looks like bias-corrected bootstrap sampling is sort of our best approach to getting our indirect effects. Yeah.
I was under the impression that you needed like a special computer to do bootstrapping. Is that true?
No, it's not.
Okay.
You need a special program to do that.
Monte Carlo? Is that what you need a special
program for? No, you need a special program for that. Like, our computing power is, like, so far beyond, like, sort of what we need, unless you're doing, like, crazy stuff. You just need a program that does it. And this is what's nice with Hayes' macros. They've created a program that can go through and do that. You just basically hijack the guts of SPSS and get it to do this for you, okay? Now, so this macro, I need to update this. I'll send you out updated information on this, but the process is still basically the same. So process, so previously we were using Hayes' indirect macro. Process is the update for this, and it just does, greater capacity than that original indirect macro. Okay. So let's go through and go back to our data set here, right? And then go through and pull up that process macro. So the macro that I've provided, or the syntax I've provided is just the raw commands for getting SPSS and loading this up into SPSS. If you go through and take a look at this, at the actual syntax file, it's a lot of stuff, right? And this can get strange and confusing. All you need to do, to load this, you can just hit Control A. I just don't want it to run my moderation analysis yet. Because I've included that at the bottom of this file. Good work.
What if you took off your command zone at the bottom, ran it, and then went back on?
I'm invested at this point.
Yeah, he's almost at the top.
So what you're doing is we're taking this whole entire macro, highlighting it, and then hitting run, and it'll tell you, yep, this is the thing we've gone through and loaded this program up. Okay. But then once it's put together, all we need to do is we can go through and say, all right, what I'll use my centered variables here that I've created. So PTSD, UI centered support, and then perceived support. I'll paste this down here at the bottom. Okay. Now with this macro, what this will do is it will go through and run all sorts of different mods. I'll post the template document for this, but basically it runs moderated, mediation, mediated, moderation, mediated, mediated, moderated variables, the three-way interactions, and all sorts of different. They've gone through and it's sort of an algorithm of different possibilities of different models you can run, right? And each one of these models is assigned a model number. And what you can do with this macro is say, all right, this is the model I want to run. Go down through and take a look and say, all right, this is consistent with this model, and then go through and run that. Now, it doesn't cover all possible models you could possibly run, but it covers a lot of them, right? And so what we would then do is once we've run this model, the very basic mediation model within process is modeled for, right? You can also run this with categorical variables and things along those lines. The macro takes care of it for you all. You just need to know what you're doing, make sure you're doing it right, and know how to interpret stuff. So what we would do then, once we've ran that, is then you have to take this command line and put in the variables that you want to run here. Right? So in this case, our variables, I'm going to just change this up. We're doing a very basic mediation model, looking at the indirect effect of PTSD on perceived support through support utilization. Right? So my Y variable is support. My X variable is reduced PTSD. My mediator is utilization. Total equals one. This is just going to give us, have it in the printout. It will list total effects for this model. If you set it to zero, it would include the total effects piece on this. Normal equals one. This will give us our normal theory estimator for our standard error. Basically, this is going to give you your Sobel test. Okay? If you set that to zero, it suppresses some help, and I'll probably wouldn't give it to you. And then your root equals 5,000. What we're going to do to estimate our standard error and our indirect effect is we're going to request 5,000 bootstrap samples. Okay? So it's going to go through, and it's going to take a sample with replacement from our original set of 300 or so, how many people we are. It's going to calculate our an estimate of our indirect relation, and then it's going to do that again and again and again and again 5,000 times. Okay, percent. It's a different indirect effect. I don't actually know if that's going to come up. And then model equals. We're looking at model four. Okay, and Hayes has a document with templates that literally will put out the conceptual model and the statistical model, and what you do is go through. You can also run moderation analysis. Make sure that you've done things if you want, right? This is a very, very flexible program. There's a lot of different things you can do with it. We're just gonna do very, very basic mediation stuff, but this is a nice tool to have, and it's something that's good to come from anyway, and so we're strongly encouraging you to use it. Stephanie, you have your hand raised?
Yeah, where did you get this from? Did I do something wrong?
What's that?
This line, line.
Oh, I created it.
Okay.
Right? It's at the top of your handout.
I thought you ran it and it popped up, and
no.
I was like, I'm insane.
No. So I've got it sort of, well, I changed the rule around some of the variables, but you can be able to see what's going on at the top here. So that's the basic command line, okay? Candace, do you have a question?
How does it know what sample size to use?
Sample size is gonna be the sample of however many people are in your sample.
Oh.
Right. You don't specify a sample.
Oh.
So the idea with bootstrapping is that I have a sample of 500. I'm going to draw 5,000 replication samples of 500 people.
Right. And it's going to take one, put it back, take one.
Exactly.
And that's how it gets a sample.
Exactly.
Okay.
Right.
Thank
so it's true in the true sense of randomness, right? It's a random sampling with replacement.
Mm-hmm.
So if you were in this data set, you could be in any given bootstrap sample. Who knows how many times, right? If you
right.
just happen to get chose, your data puts in next person, next person, next person,
mm-hmm.
right? And so what you can't do is say I have a population set of 30 people, but I wanted to draw bootstrap samples of 100 people, right? That's not going to work, right? So the size of your sample is however many people in your sample, and you're just redrawing the replacement. Other questions about what's going on with this? Yes.
Why is it 5,000?
Because I set it at 5,000. You make it 1,000. I mean, at some point, I could put in 10 million, but it's sort of the incremental benefit of running 10 million bootstrap samples is probably going to be zero above and beyond 5. I mean, I just kind of arbitrary. Hayes has 1,000. If you put in 8 million, it's going to take you a really long time to run that versus what's going on. So, other questions? Yes. Model 4 is, if you go through and take a look, and I'll post this up so you guys can take a look at this. Model 4 is the template for basic mediation. Model 1 is the template for simple moderation, right? And this goes through and you can just go through and say, and there's a model in there that looks at mediated mediation. And
because you go through that, that's probably the one to take a look at. There's all sorts of indirect effects there, because in that case, we'll get to that in a minute. But other questions about what we've got going on here? Okay. So once we've gone through and created that, we ran the macro, loaded that up, created our command, and then we're just going to run this.
Do we need to do descriptors
in this macro? Can't if you want. That's just because I'm lazy and I don't want to misspell variables. That's all. We just cut things and drop things. Okay. And so this is our output, right? Some things, and again, this is sort of listed on your handout, so you can take a look here. Things we want to do and make sure that we're taking account of. First, take a look at your model statement. We are running model 4. Our variables. My Y variable is support, my X variable is PTSD, my mediator is support utilization, my sample size is 304. Look at that. Don't ignore it. Make sure everything's right, right? That you can switch around your X and Y and your mediators. Make sure that it's estimating the model that you think it should be estimating. Okay? Then we go through, and this first part, this is just all your basic regression. There's nothing special or terribly exciting in these first couple of models above and beyond what you would have done with your initial causal effects, right? So in this first regression model, our outcome is our centered utilization, our predictor is PTSD, right? If we take a look at the coefficients of this model, how should those relate to the ones that we just ran by hand in SPSS? The identical, right? If you go through and we take a look at what we've got up here, and we go through and compare that with the coefficients that we ran from, this would be our second model, model 2. We see that the effect for PTSD on utilization, SPSS, and our standard output gave us 251, 251. Standard error, 0.3030, 300. T is the same. It's all the same stuff, right? So all we're doing with this first output, this is just a standard OLS model for our new path, right? Our next one, this is going to be our final model, where we have our outcome is our perceived support, and we have regressing perceived support on PTSD, the support utilization. If we go to our last model that we ran by hand, model 3, and we take a look at that, all of our coefficients are the same. All of our model stuff is the same. Process isn't doing anything special outside of just running your causal effects models here as you would normally do, okay? But again, this is a nice way to double check the stuff that you have done, because everything should match up, and if it doesn't, something's going to arise somewhere, okay? People sort of with me to this point on what's going on? Okay. And then we've got this last model, outcome support. What's this model giving us, Julia? What path are we getting here with this?
The Y onto both mediator and X.
For this one?
Outcome is support.
Our outcome is support. What's our predictor?
Oh, sorry. That's just the X.
Right. It's our C path, right? Process is just running that one last, right? But process is giving us all the pieces and parts that we would need to get if we wanted to go through and derive our Schoenel standard errors and things along those lines. This is where we start to get stuff that's sort of more useful, right? So here under this total direct and indirect effects, we have total effects of X on Y, okay? Sean, what are we getting here with total effects of X on Y?
Just the
yeah, just the direct path, right? Now, what this is sort of redundant with just our regular X path with this simple mediation model. But as you start to get more elaborate models, right, what you're looking at, this is the combination of all possible effects of X on whatever your outcome is through your different moderators, mediators, things along those lines. This can start to get more elaborate when you get more complicated models going on. We also have the direct effects of X on Y. Trent, what do you think direct effects of X on Y are referring to here? So if this is our total effect, this is our functionally our C path. What about direct effects of X on Y? What's that given us? Okay. So this is C. What's this? C prime, right? So our total effects in our simple mediation model is just the relation between X and Y. Our direct effects of X on Y is this, we're pulling this from our final model and looking at the residual relation between X on Y. And again, if you're confused, you can go through and actually compare these coefficients with the other stuff above, and you can see where this is coming from, right? This is the residual relation between X and Y, so this is your C prime path, right? And then we get the indirect effect of X on Y, okay? Indirect effect of X on Y, Lucy, what's this effect or this coefficient correspond to?
This is our overall mediation.
Right, which is consistent with in our basic model. What does this correspond to? Or not in sort of our conceptual model, not the. C minus C prime, but in this, we're typically thinking about this as AB, right? It's just more conceptually consistent to think about this as your indirect effect. This is the product of AB. This is the indirect relation as opposed to thinking about this as the reduction in C minus C prime. You're right, that's exact mathematically, it's the same thing. But within these models, we're talking about sort of this indirect relation between X and Y as opposed to X on Y through M as opposed to a reduction in the C prime. Okay? And so what we see here is we get an indirect effect of X on Y through utilization. This is our coefficient. Does this coefficient look familiar? You're shaking your head, yeah. Zach, why is it? It's the same as what we calculated, right? The calculation of your indirect effect, there's nothing special going on here, right? This is literally the product of your A and your B paths, right? There's nothing going on in the bootstrapped effect that goes through and changes that. This is just an OLS estimate, right? Where we get the bootstrap stuff is we get a bootstrap standard error, and then we get confidence and bootstrap, bias-corrected bootstrap confidence intervals for this, right? And so, although you could take that and divide it by that to get a test statistic, you don't need that because you've got something better, which is just your confidence interval saying that this is my point estimate, and this is my 95% confidence interval for that indirect effect. Right? This indirect effect does not contain zero. Therefore, we conclude that it's a statistically reliable effect based on our bootstrap standard errors. Okay. And so this is what's useful, right? This is what's giving us stuff that we didn't get before or couldn't get using our causal effects models. And generally what we'll find is this bias-corrected bootstrap confidence interval piece here. This is going to be a more powerful test of your indirect effect than using SOPEL, particularly if you have small samples, particularly if you are working with more modest effect sizes. This is where you're going to get the benefit for your bootstrapping procedure. Final thing we have here is our normal theory test, okay? Normal theory test for our indirect effect. So that, again, this is our effect. That's fine, that's the same because that's just a pretty straightforward calculation. Here is our SOPEL standard error. Here, it's pretty much the same, right? But we've got a large sample, right? So there's probably not too much going on here. But this would be our SOPEL. This is our Z and this is our P, right? And so you can go through and start comparing and contrasting things. Now, I'm going through and I'm taking a look and I'm seeing that what we've actually done here is calculated a percentile bootstrap confidence interval, which is actually not what we want to do.
Ah, there we go. Okay. Go through in your original, make a note. Hit percent equals zero. Okay. That changed the derivation of our bootstrapped effect. So we've got, so these are all going to be the same. Our bias corrected bootstrap effect is now, so you see some change a little bit in how that was calculated. What I'll do is I'll go through and put together an updated slide to let you know some of the different options that are going along with this. For the purposes of this class, just stick with the bias corrected bootstrap approach. But you can see there's a minor change to that. Looking down, we see number of bootstrap samples for bias corrected confidence intervals. So again, a nice example of why it's always good to read all of your output and make sure there's not something funky going on. So questions about how to use process, how to set it up, and how to go through and do it, benefits and why this is useful above and beyond a better option for VinSoPel. Everybody understand with these tools at our disposal, there's really no reason to run a Sobel. Again, you know, usually use a stone axe when we have perfectly good tools going on, right? So that could have certain things expected on the use of Sobel.
Too bad.
Right. Okay, cool. So the idea, again, as opposed when we start to getting into these different models, again, the focus being more about the indirect effect of X on Y through your intervening variable, because this is really kind of what we're looking for. Before, we were sort of focused on this reduction of C to C prime, but now, sort of talking about more about this in terms of the indirect effect of X on Y through M, and that being the primary focus with some of the process models. And then as we start to get into more complex models, sort of this ends up being a much more flexible approach than try to determine this coefficient reduces it by this much depending on where it's at in the model and things like that. Our bootstrap confidence intervals gives us a correct test of AB, right, is sort of whatever it is, and then we've got a 95% confidence interval telling us whether or not that's statistically reliable at 95% confidence level, and sort of the R is always range plausible values for what that indirect effect may be look like based on sort of the in the population based on the data that we have available to us. I'm comfortable with this? Okay. And again, you'll start to see, and we are seeing this in terms of research out there being used more and more. This is just an incredible tool by Dr. Hayes that makes these models much more accessible than they had been previously in the past. So, if we start to look at extensions on this, we can start to get moderation with higher order terms, three-way interactions, different quadratic cubic functions, things like that. We can start laying out different types of analyses here. Mediation with covariates, right? Looking at mediational pathways, controlling for other variables in the model. This is easy to do in the process in that statement that we used. If you had, let's say you wanted to include gender as a mediator, you just type in gender as another variable in the model, and then it's just going to include gender as a covariate and all of those. It's easy to run through and remove. Multiple mediators, right? Let's say that instead of supporting utilization, we also wanted to look at type of trauma as a mediator of that relationship. We maybe think that some people exposed to certain types of events may have higher support than other people. What we can do is just send that M statement, type in trauma type, right? And then it's going to go through and take a look. And this is where you're going to start to get specific indirect effects of X on Y through here, X on Y through this, X on Y. And so you start seeing additional lines laid out in your output there, right? Total effects, and so this is where thinking about these in terms of reliable indirect relations start to make more sense, because C minus C prime starts, because if we just directly measure the direct effects of X on Y, we've got four different mediators. Well, what's the C prime, like how do we go through and start? Because C prime is now just the residual relationship after we take care of all of this stuff. It starts to become more difficult to say what's that C minus C prime movement. But what we can say is this is the indirect of X on Y through M1, controlling for the effect of all these other things, right? And we can look at that specific effect, test whether or not this is reliable, whether or not this is reliable, whether or not this is reliable. We can start to get more elaborate with this. And this is actually not a difficult model to test, right? We can also look at moderated mediation, mediated moderation, right? Is the indirect effect of X on Y through M, is that indirect effect, is AB, is the magnitude direction of AB change depending on who we're talking about, or at some different level of a third variable? We can also look at mediated moderation, whether or not interactive effect between X and X2 is mediated by a third variable. So lots of different types of analyses that we can start to run, think about. And this process macro provides a very nice and efficient way to go through and start looking at this without having to delve into SEM programs and things along those lines. Again, nothing wrong with using SEM programs to do this, and it's actually technically a more flexible way to do it, because you can start with a lot of types of things that you might want to do. This is a perfectly reasonable and accessible way to do things. You just want to make sure that you know what you're doing, know how to tell it to know what you're doing, and then be able to reasonably interpret whatever analysis that you've gone through. Questions? People feeling comfortable about running macro, how to set up the model, things like that? It's actually pretty straightforward, right? This will be a less intensive problem set experience than the moderation one, but still make sure you jump on, get an early start with things. Questions on any of this? Questions on problem set 4? All right, cool. What we'll do is we'll talk about ANCOVA stuff next week. The business about multivariate means testing with ANOVA and stuff like that. I'm going to spend a lot of time on that just because I don't know when the last time I saw ANOVA, you know, psychological variable was. It's just not something that we end up doing a whole lot, so we'll probably cut that out for in terms of it, trying to make reasonable progress moving forward on stuff. But so we'll work through ANCOVA stuff, talk about some of the conceptual issues with that, uses and misuses, make sure we know Chapman on that, and then what we'll do is we'll have problem set 5. We'll be doing next Friday, and I'm going to work with Tess to see if we can get those turned around reasonably so we can get those back to you, because what I'd like to do is then have the exam not next week but the following, so 2 weeks from now, have the exam, but wanting you to get your sets back so you can take a look, make sure that you're shored up on anything that we covered in set in this set 5 before you go into that exam. So that's what I'm thinking. That'll be the plan moving forward. I may go through show of hands who would prefer to have one of those screeners cut on the next set.
Got a screener?
Yeah.
Get your hand up back.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
No, that whatever pain I put you through to some degree is transferred over to Tess and I in terms of doing that stuff. So no free lunch for us. But what's up? Yeah, I did. So we'll go through and make sure that you have an opportunity to practice that, take away some of the ins and outs to give you sort of more time to make sure you're up on reading and things on those lines. And then so we'll plan on having our exam within 2 weeks.
Yep.
After this effect, you have 137, which is normally, right? And then the week after, we, where do you have the difference?
So we would have. Because the other thing I don't want to do is, so the exam would be sort of all the regression stuff that we've gone through. I don't want to pile on a bunch of other stuff that then sort of starts to interfere with things. So right now, exam or set five, will we do the 7th. And so the exam would be the 12th.
Oh, sorry.
Does that make, is that?
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Okay. That sound squared away, sounds like a plan of action moving forward with things? Perfect. Okay, cool. Have fun finishing up set 4. Again, another thing I would say with these sets, longer is not always better, right? If we're not, if you've got, unless I explicitly say, hey, tell me about every single coefficient in the model, you don't have to go through and sort of talk about every single coefficient in the model. Just sort of focus on the stuff that is, and then note that sort of, oh, this is, because it doesn't make a whole lot of sense to go through and provide sort of interpretations for every single effect in the model if they're not reliable anyway, right? And so if you've got things that are marginal, you can go through and talk about those, but if you work through and streamline, so say, these are the effects that we found would be statistically reliable, these ones weren't, and so writing interpretation after interpretation of the confidence intervals that clearly zero falls dead in the middle of the center of it, not a terribly good use of your time, right? So going through, thinking about what do we need to interpret, what do we not need to interpret, can you sort of relegate to, and then there was also this, demonstrating, you know, kind of what the difference is and sort of talking about some of this stuff. And now if I say, hey, tell me everything that you could possibly tell me about this, then cool. Otherwise, sort of go through. If you have questions, come ask me. Say, hey, Bozo, do you want us to tell you every single thing in the universe about this? I'm like, no, go ahead and streamline that down. Talk about this, that, and the other thing, right? Because sometimes what happens, you give me so much information that you incidentally spoil your answer, which is not good, right? Basically, it's like sort of cross-examine. Like, I let you talk yourself into getting yourself into trouble. Or what it ends up being sort of horribly redundant, right? Where you're just saying the same thing over and over again. Some level of repetition, I think, is helpful, but at some point, it gets to be not a terribly useful thing, right? So, again, if you have questions, come talk to me. Again, sort of save yourself some time and effort to do this. So. All right. Cool.